Let's move on now to the real world. I've mentioned a couple of times the challenges of real world samples, and I'm going to talk about a project that I was asked to get involved with when the project team decided to measure Zeta potential. The product is a 0.4% weight per volume aqueous suspension of a deworming compound called albendazole. It comes in a 10 milliliter plastic vial and is a single oral dose, as opposed to having a reservoir where you meter a known amount of the suspension for delivery. The formulation is highly viscous and sediments very slowly. As a result, it forms a compact sediment. It's important that the patient can resuspend the drug with minimum effort and that it sufficiently disperses to ensure the patient gets the full dose. In 2013, that wasn't an issue. One of the quality control tests used involves a LumiSizer to centrifuge a sample, followed by looking at the appearance of the supernatant and then shaking the sample to assess the redispersibility of the sediment. In 2015, there were product failures. The amount of the drug getting resuspended was low because it wasn't possible to fully redisperse the sediment. You can see the post-sedimentation differences in the top two images. So what may have changed? And what are the important features from a colloid science perspective that may be affecting this behavior? So let me talk a bit about sedimentation and redispersion processes and how it can be affected by the Zeta potential. If you have a high Zeta potential, then it's likely you will slow any aggregation, and as a result, you'll get slow settling. This will allow a tight sediment to form that will require considerable energy to redisperse. This is made worse by increasing viscosity. It's highly probable that you'll leave some of the sediment behind and you will fail your quality control test. What about low Zeta potential? You'll get fast aggregation, limited by the diffusion and concentration of the particles. Aggregates that form will settle faster than individual particles. This will form a loose, fluffy sediment, and that will readily resuspend. But it doesn't necessarily redisperse to the original primary particles. So you get the right amount of the material back in the liquid, but it isn't uniform. Now, for this product, it may not matter as long as the patient can get the entire dose. I know from experience with a different product that the optimum aggregation state could lie somewhere between these two extremes. How do you make use of the Zeta potential data if you want to try and come up with the optimum aggregation state? Do you use a quality by design approach? Can you demonstrate that the Zeta potential is a critical quality attribute? Can you use the measurement of Zeta potential to determine if your manufacturing process or your stability testing is going to fail? To answer that, you need to understand the composition of your product. You need to understand the colloid science, and you need to understand why you want to measure the Zeta potential. This is the composition of the product I'm referring to. It has 14 components. There's one ionic surfactant. There are two non-ionic surfactants. There is a polymer. There are five simple ionic compounds. There are two simple non-ionic compounds. There are two particulates, the drug itself, and a clay to increase viscosity. There are more viscosity modifiers. Not all of the ingredient structures are known. Elucidating a mechanism in this system that could explain the observation leading to failure and linking that somehow to Zeta potential is not going to happen. To measure the Zeta potential for something like this by electrophoretic light scattering is a big challenge. It has to be diluted. And there's the clay. It's a lot bigger than the drug, and it's got a higher refractive index. So it may dominate the scattered light signal, and you may not see a difference in the zeta potential, even though the drug particles may be demonstrating some different surface chemistry that would lead to a different zeta potential. It could explain why you're having a problem, but you won't see it because it's swamped by the other particulate material in your product. Diluting can affect surface equilibria. If a surfactant you're using is weakly adsorbed onto the drug particles, then on dilution, it may desorb and your measured zeta potentials may be completely unrelated to the zeta potential of the original product. So do you try and measure the zeta potential of the diluted particles at the original concentration of surfactant, or do you dilute the surfactant as well? There's no simple answer to that. I've explained the challenge of going from the electrophoretic mobility to zeta potential. So even if you assume your zeta potential data are due to your drug particles and nothing else, how can you estimate your value of kappa? And how can you estimate your value of A, the radius? Kappa requires knowledge of all of the ionic materials and their valences. If you look at the list, there are many ionic components. For example, the saccharine sodium. You need to know the dissociation constant under the conditions that you're storing your sample. Does the surfactant fully ionize, or is it only weakly dissociated? Is it weakly adsorbed onto the drug? There are many fundamental questions that you simply will not be able to answer. You can be more pragmatic. If you can't realistically validate the assumptions associated with making the measurements, then you can use quality by design approach to determine if zeta potential is a critical quality attribute. You measure the zeta potential to see if it's changed, but you don't need to know why it changed. You just want to know that it changes in a way that can indicate if your product is going to stay within its specification limits as far as product conformance and shelf life are concerned. If you do identify the zeta potential as a critical quality attribute, then you can lock down a method on a particular instrument for making routine measurements on your product, and you don't need to know the absolute value of the zeta potential.